is an oral interview with Mr. Mark Marzola of 210 Texas Street, recorded at the Potrero Branch Library on September 15th, 1970.
Are you sure that's recording? This is the history of Potrero Hill, also known as Scotch Hill. The Spaniards called it Potrero Nuevo, or New Pasture. The Christianized Indians at Mission Dolores were trained to be vaqueros. The main exports from California during the Spanish rule were hides and tallow. The meat was consumed here or dried in the sun for local use. Potrero Hill was the ideal pasture as it was bounded on 3.5 sides by Mission Bay on the north, and San Francisco Bay on the east, and Mission Creek on the north side also, and the swamps of Islas Creek, which was large, much larger than Mission Creek. Cattle were slaughtered around the Potrero and Alameda streets to supply the gold rush boom in San Francisco in 1849, when the sailing ships arrived in bunches, never to sail again, as the crews deserted to make their fortune in the streams of the great motherlode country. As sailing ships needed new ropes, a cordage work was started by the Tubbs family in 1854 on a tract of land 8 square blocks, bounded by 20th and Iowa to 23rd and Iowa to the bay. The sailing ships could come alongside of the works, which extended into the bay about a block east of the present-day 3rd Street. This cordage company went out of business in 1966 after 110 years of rope-making, and the 8 square blocks are now an industrial park. The works were well kept up, had trees and flowers, and a stone bridge over a creek that flowed through the works. The next and the greater industry was the Union Iron Works at 20th and Illinois, started by Peter Donahue to make mining machinery for the gold mines, lumber machinery for lumber mills, locomotives, and gas house apparatus to make illuminating gas for the new cities that were springing up like mushrooms. The employees of these waterfront industries were isolated from downtown San Francisco by Mission Bay. To get to San Francisco, people had to go around the western edge of Mission Bay, hampered by muddy roads, as there were no paved roads. So a community of shipyard workers and rope workers was started on Tennessee Street. It had 3 churches, an opera house, schools, stores. As the working hours were from 10 to 12 hours a day, people lived very close to the place of their employment.
About what period was this, Mr. Marzola?
Well, the 12-hour day was abolished in 1918 on the railroads.
And this is the period you're talking about here.
Yeah. The opera house was used for traveling shows, political meetings, etc. In 1868, a bridge about 3/4 mile long was built to connect the Potrero with downtown San Francisco. It extended from 4th and Townsend to Mariposa and Kentucky Street, now known as 3rd Street. Another piling bridge about 1 mile long extended from 26th and Kentucky to Hunter's Point, called Railroad Avenue. Now it's all 3rd Street. These bridges later became embankments as each side was gradually filled in with fill from the grading operations on Potrero Hill, garbage, etc. Soon horse car transportation, namely the Potrero and Bayview Railroad, was available to go to downtown San Francisco or to Hunter's Point or the Bayview Racetrack. Around 1893, there was an economic depression, and the United States government became aware of the nation's lack of naval power. Iron ships were ordered, built. Four warships were built at the Union Iron Works, the Charleston, the Monterey, the Olympia, and the great battleship Oregon. These ships were completed in time for engagement in the war with Spain. The Oregon was sent around the end of Cape Horn at full speed to engage the fleets of Spain in Cuban waters. The Olympia was sent to Manila Bay as Admiral Dewey's flagship. Incidentally, the Battle of Manila Bay lasted about 24 hours. Many men from the British Isles came to work here in the Union Iron Works. The Scotch workers, with shipbuilding experience, lived higher up on Potrero Hill. The unskilled workers lived on the flatlands and on Irish Hill, which was east of 3rd Street, around 20th and 22nd Street. It was graded down around 1912 to make room for the shipyard expansion.
Is Bethlehem Steel?
Well, it was Union Iron Works then. It disappeared entirely in 1916 to make warships for World War I. Another shipbuilding boom, the Union Iron Works was sold to the Bethlehem Steel in World War I. Another shipbuilding boom started with the discovery of gold in Alaska in 1897. Many river boats and barges were built for the Yukon River, the Columbia River, and the Sacramento River. Incidentally, that the only Delta Queen on the Mississippi was built in San Francisco.
Isn't that right?
Yeah.
Didn't San Francisco enjoy a period as being a shipbuilding port of the West?
Oh, yes. Well, Los Angeles. In 1900, Los Angeles had only 100,000 people. I don't think that much. And Seattle and Portland were small. The trolley car made its appearance around 1896. This enabled the more affluent workers to move out of the Potrero to better neighborhoods, as the railroad yards and roundhouse made a great deal of noise day and night. The city's garbage was burnt at 15th and De Harris Street starting 1896. The whaling ships dried their whalebone on the slopes of Potrero Hill. From 1895 to 1900, they dried their whalebone on the slopes of Potrero Hill from 1895 to 1905. Also, the odors from Butchertown, slaughterhouses, and hog raising on wharves fed on the slops from the city's restaurants. Also, most of the workers' homes had no bathtubs or toilets, only a backyard affair. No electric lights, only kerosene lamps or gas lights. However, people were happier then than now. The boys had social clubs held neighborhood dances. One boy would study accordion, the other one banjo, and the other one drums, and they supplied the music for these neighborhood dances. New songs didn't appear so frequently, so everybody could learn them in due time. Won't You Come Home, Bill Bailey, appeared in 1891, and it's still popular.
That's right.
Traveling minstrel shows and vaudeville came to the local opera house. Boys could go to work at the age of 14. They were self-reliant. They helped their parents. They did not take the drugs, yet you could buy without a prescription any drugstore until 1913. See, the Harrison Narcotic Act was enacted in 1913. Political problems in Russia caused many religious groups in 1905 and 6 to emigrate to the United States. The Baptists, Molokans, and liberals of some sort settled on top of the hill and bought lots and built their own homes.
This is around the Carolina.
Yeah, Carolina, yeah.
Colorado.
They got away. They'd like Heights. To isolate themselves, you see.
Southern Heights, that whole area.
Yeah, yeah. The Scotch wanted to live away from the Irish. They moved up here. the Catholic Church was down on Tennessee, and they finally moved it up to 19th and Connecticut.
Right, right.
Yeah.
Now, the Scotch lived on another part of the...
Hmm?
The Scotch lived off 20th Street around Connecticut.
Well, they lived all around the top of the hill. Overlooking the bay, the superintendents and the higher officials of the Union Ironworks lived up there. Sea captains, et cetera, you know.
Yes, yeah, I read about it. Yeah. A house that still has a widow's walk.
Yeah. Wait a minute, let's see, where were I? In April 1906, the earthquake and fire burnt 80% of the workers' homes in San Francisco, while the middle class out in the Western Addition or Pacific Heights or Car Hollow suffered very little. People fled to Potrero Hill, Twin Peaks, and the marina. The army provided tents and corned beef, hardtack, etc. They had a big supply, I guess, as a result of the Spanish-American War. They probably overstocked.
Didn't they have tents up here to help the refugees?
Oh, yes.
And
later they made houses.
Temporary
shacks, and there was one on 19th and Connecticut. I could spot it. It was down in a little hole. It was a two-room affair. It was portable. You could assemble it and take it down and put it together.
My goodness.
Hmm?
My goodness. I hadn't realized that.
Yeah. Where was that? Oh, yeah. The refugees were soon employed in rebuilding the city and soon were able to buy a piece of land on the hill. The railroads prospered, and a battle of railroad giants emerged. These giants sought land for their terminals, the Northern Pacific, Southern Pacific, Santa Fe, and the Western Pacific. The Southern Pacific had their terminal at 4th and Townsend. Their roundhouse was at 15th and Harrison. The Santa Fe had a terminal at Richmond, California. Their freight cars had to be ferried over on barges to the base of Potrero Hill. The Western Pacific ferried their freight cars to the southern end of Potrero Hill, and they bored a tunnel under Potrero Hill to reach their terminal at 9th and Brannan. This tunnel burned down in 1966 and had to be filled with cement and abandoned.
This created the problems for some of the houses that were built on top.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
And these houses were lost.
Yeah. The Southern Pacific decided to shorten the railroad route to Los Angeles and bored 5 tunnels, two under Potrero Hill and 3 more under the hills of Bayview and Visitation Valley. They also built a trestle across about a mile long across Isla's Creek swamplands. Mm. There was a big swamp there. Now it... Hmm?
Mr. Marzola, can you tell us the location of the Potrero Hill Tunnel?
Yes, it started at Sierra and...
Sierra.
Well, that's a little street.
Oh, I know Sierra.
Yeah.
Right off Missouri. Yeah.
Sierra and Texas to, Carolina and 16th. That was the other end of the tunnel.
Yeah, they went on a diagonal.
Yeah, diagonal, yeah.
And you said there were two tunnels.
You want to shut that off?
No, I want you to tell us this.
Oh, well, the E.H. Harriman, the railroad giant, wanted to merge the Union Pacific with the Southern Pacific. Uh-huh. The Southern Pacific owned the Pacific Mail Steamship Company, so he pictured a big terminal at south of the county line. But in the meanwhile, the government broke up his dream, saying it would be a monopoly because railroad companies would grant rebates if you rode on a Pacific Mail Steamship Company from China and Japan and Peru or what have you, you see. So they broke up that combination. Incidentally, the Central Pacific used to go around the Great Salt Lake. Then they decided to build a trestle 31 miles long, made of piling. They figured out over a period of years it would pay for itself. you see. And later on, they tore down a big hill, a mountain, and filled the trestle with earth. Now you cross over, and you don't see that trestle. It's buried. Same way with this trestle in Isla's Creek. They gradually threw dirt on each side, and they gradually filled it up. So the cattle couldn't get away from Potrero Hill. There was a little two or three blocks of vaqueros had to chase them back up here. So that's the reason. Originally, it was a grazing ground. Then a few energetic individuals started small dairies.
I understand there was a dairy on 20th
Street. Yeah.
The barns were across where Atchison's pharmacy.
Yeah, they were.
Yeah.
There were several of them. Well, let me get back to
we're talking about the
tunnels under.
Yeah, I just wanted to. I think it would be helpful to people to know where those tunnels were. So we have the one now from Sierra and Missouri going to Texas.
Well, the Southern Pacific, Harriman was going to build an electric road.
Mm-hmm.
So he had one tunnel for the electric, the other for the steam. The steam would go to Los Angeles and continue on to New Orleans. You see? But the government broke up his plans, and I get the remainder of the Harriman left him a bunch of money for a pension for 40-year employees. So I get the residue at $6 a month. I get a check every month from the lad. Now, they also built a new roundhouse at the foot of Mariposa, extending from Pennsylvania to 3rd Street. Their freight classification yards extended from 7th Street to 3rd Street on 26 acres of filled-in Mission Bay. They built overhead viaducts over their freight yards so streetcars and other traffic would not be blocked. One extended up 6th Street, another one over to 16th Street, up 16th Street, and one over 3rd Street, which is still there. You see that black viaduct on 3rd? At 16th is a viaduct. You can drive up in case of freight cars are blocking you.
Yes, I know.
Mm-hmm. All right. Well, later on, in 1918, freight traffic reached its zenith. So a larger classification yard was built just over the county line at Bay Shore. New repair shops here were built, also a new roundhouse for freight locomotives. This alleviated some of the noise which disturbed people's sleep at night on Potrero Hill. Whistles, bells, and the crash of freight cars being juggled around all night long. World War I started in 1914, and orders were placed with the Union Iron Works for destroyers. After the United States became involved in 1917, 18,000 men were employed in the Union Iron Works. Because electric welding was not yet perfected, and oxyacetylene cutting or welding did not come into use. These thousands of men worked around the clock. There were 7 stores on 3rd Street open all night selling overalls, shirts, gloves, and many restaurants were open 24 hours a day. I used to go down and eat 3 o'clock in the morning on 20th Street, 20th and 3rd. The trolley cars went right into the shipyards from many lines to save time for the workers. Even cement boats were built, besides many wooden ships, to carry lumber for the war boom. They were built at Eureka and Gray's Harbor. Even wooden airplanes were built to conserve steel. The Great Bethlehem Steel was bought out the Union Iron Works and built a hospital at 18th and Pennsylvania. It is now a private rest home. Many shipyard workers bought new homes or remodeled the older ones and had their own bathtubs. Before that, they went to the barber shop. The men and the women were left the ship for themselves. There was a lot of barber shops on 3rd Street.
Oh, my goodness.
Each barber shop you got a haircut and a shave Saturday night and a bath. You see, they had 6 or 8 tubs.
I never heard of that.
The homes didn't have them. The poor working man couldn't afford a bathtub. Well, anyway, while the original city planners knew that the Potrero Hill had the most sunshine and laid out wider streets, the nuisance industries, combined with the politicians, they prevailed. Now the hill real estate is in great demand. World War II, the shipyards were very busy, but with fewer workers due to the electric welding and gas cutting and welding, new techniques, etc. But for the first time in the history of railroading, women were hired to work in locomotive roundhouse. As smoke, grease, and oil and noise was everywhere, the women built and tended fires in the locomotives, shoveled sand in the sand house. The sand was used for the air brakes. They wiped the locomotives and for a while helped mechanics. They gradually got married or found better employment. The last woman retired in July 1970, and now the roundhouse is gone and only a few diesel locomotives are parked at 7th and Townsend Street. Sure.
Who's that?
Nora Gould. She come from Harlem. Trains used to run to Santa Cruz. There was a little train line went over the Santa Cruz Mountains down into Santa Cruz. They ran to passenger trains to Tres Pinos, to Monterey. Now only one train a day to Los Angeles and one to Monterey. The writer worked for 43 years in the railroad roundhouse, and it was a very interesting and exciting experience. Now peace and quiet prevails, except for the pollution from the auto exhaust, because everybody wants speed. The county hospital was located on Potrero Avenue near 22nd, also a school for wayward girls. The pest house...
Torn
down. St. Catherine's home. It was a Catholic outfit.
Was that near the hospital?
Yeah, there's a stone grotto where they had the Virgin Mary in there now. I think it's still there, the grotto.
What happened to...
the school?
Yeah.
They discontinued.
What was the name of the school?
St. Catherine Home.
And you remember when it was torn down?
It was a wooden building. It was torn down.
When? Recently.
I tell you, who can tell you? Miss Cassiano. Do you know Miss Cassiano?
Not offhand. I don't think I do.
She knows you.
Oh.
She lives on Texas Street.
Oh, I know who you mean.
Yeah. She lived across the street. She could tell you. She could tell you the exact date.
Yeah, she's a nurse.
The pest house, as it was called, was for all contagious diseases. Leprosy, smallpox, yellow fever, etc., was located on Army Street near Evans. As the roads were not paved in those days, the afternoon winds raised clouds of dust, which gave the old shed-like buildings a gloomy appearance.
Now, about what period of time is this, Mr. Marzola?
Well, it was still there in 1920.
So sometime prior to 1920.
Yeah. You're talking about. There was a streetcar that started in at 8th and Market, and you transferred from the 22 car stopped at Bryant Street, and you had to transfer to number 30. It went around 3rd Street and up Army Street. The streetcar was there, but the street wasn't paved. But before 1896, it was just clouds of dust. Even 1910, it wasn't even paved yet. The dust would fly up. Let's see, we're getting away from... Woolen mills, hair curling works, paint factories, glue works were on the west side of Potrero Hill.
And that would be streets such as?
Well, Bryant, Potrero Avenue. The bottom of Potrero Hill is Harrison Street.
Right.
There's where the water from Potrero Hill went down Harrison from Twin Peaks, and it made Mission Creek.
Right. And And that's all I know. You told me the other day, been filled
you
in.
Couldn't. The cows couldn't get away, or the cattle. Well, let's see. With electric streetcars available in 1897 on, the executors of the eccentric millionaire James Lick and Wilmerding and Melinda Lux built schools to teach building trades. The Lux School taught girls, it was for girls, dressmaking, millinery trades, and household economics. Now, they didn't teach business because no girls engage in business. They were all bookkeepers were men. Even telephone operators were men.
Now, the pendulum has...
The funds that were endowed were depleted after about 50 years by inflation, so that the land and buildings were sold. They probably borrowed money in the meanwhile and had to pay the loans off. The Lux School was sold to Machinist Union and still stands there. The Lick Wilmerding schools were demolished around 1960, and the property is now the United Parcel Delivery headquarters and garage. Now, the Lux School still stands down there. It's on 17th and Potrero Avenue. You see that big building there?
Near the park, like.
Yeah. Melinda Lux was the widow of the great cattle kings. Miller and Lux, they owned all that land on the west side of the San Joaquin River. They raised cattle. They had a big slaughterhouse here at Butchertown, you see. So the executors of the estate, well, they saw a chance. But when the streetcars came here, that is electric cars, well, then they bought pieces of land. Here's a good place. Then there was another character, Cogswell. He built a Cogswell Industrial School. But he was a prohibitionist. That is, he had statues. There's one statue in Washington Square. It was originally right on the corner of the Barbary Coast, Pacific and Columbus Avenue. It advocated drinking the water. One faucet said Vichy water, the other soda water, but it was all plain water. And he had a statue of Benjamin Franklin to encourage you to be thrifty. But the Cogswell School, I can dig you up the data on that later. But that old fountain is still in Washington Square. You know, that's on North Beach area, you know. Yeah, it's still there. So I didn't mention dairies or housing projects. The first housing project was permanent. That is, tile roofs and copper fittings on the roof so the seawater wouldn't...
Which one is that?
Well, that's the one here, but then...
Now, that's the one over on back of Connecticut. Yeah.
And then when World War One come on, they built them all over. They built them at Hunter's Point. I had two lots at Hunter's Point. I paid $150 for each one of them, and I used to go swimming and weekends, you know. You could buy shrimps for 3 pounds for 25 cents, them nice little shrimps.
When was this housing project?
Well, that was built around right after the Depression was started. See, they had artists painting up in Coit Tower and...
Oh, this is during the
WP. Yeah, it was something WPA like a WPA project. Yeah.
Well, I think this has been just fascinating. I think it would be interesting if we could talk a little bit about you. You were born in Martinez.
Mm-hmm.
When, Mr. Marzola?
1889, January.
And when did you come to San Francisco?
1894.
And you didn't come directly to the Hill, though.
Oh, no. We moved to Filbert and Columbus Avenue. At that time, it was called Montgomery Avenue.
Oh, yeah.
Then they changed it to Columbus Avenue. But a lot of street names that were notorious would change. Grant Avenue used to be DuPont Street on account of houses of ill fame. Next door to the county jail was Broadway and Hinckley Alley and Pinckley Alley. They changed them names because they're full of houses of ill fame. And the county jail was where Pinocchio Club is today, if you know where that is.
And in North Beach.
Yeah. And Morton Lane was changed to Union Square Avenue. That's one block over Market Street. Well, you see, there was no jobs for women. If a woman became a widow, she was out of luck. She either had to go to work in dance halls. Yeah, well, you will say, well, she could have worked as a maid. The rich people imported their maids from France and Germany and England, especially Irish girls. And then later on, Donald Dealey Cameron used to rescue the slave girls. The police wouldn't rescue them. So she'd hire private detectives, and they'd break the door down and get these girls out. They were slave girls. They were bought in China. When I used to deliver bread to the Barbary Coast about 11 at night...
And this was about when?
Hmm?
About
1901. Barbary Coast was its heyday.
Yeah.
Because the people come down from Alaska loaded with money. The Philippine War ended, and the soldiers come back from the Philippines with money. So all them dives... They'd change their name periodically. Around 1900, there were campfire, the recruit, different names, you know, connected with the war. Before that, the original builders of the Barbary Coast evidently studied Greek mythology because they had the Thalia, the Apollo,
oh my.
The Andromeda. In fact, Stackpole, the great sculptor, designed some plaster Paris. You'd call them satyrs, half goat and half man.
Oh, yes.
And I think Stackpole, he was a Stackpole? No, wait a minute. Well, he run a bill, and the same way all the artists had run a bill, Izzy Gomez, you've heard of Izzy Gomez?
Oh, yes.
Well, they'd run a bill and then they'd paint. He had over the bar quotations for Omar Khayyam. I remember one. Into the fires of spring, throw your winter garments of repentance. Oh, no, your winter garments of repentance, fling. Incidentally, the first time I went in there...
This is where again now?
Pacific Street.
Ah.
Izzy Gomez was a big, fat Portuguese from the Cape Verde Islands. So he was very inquisitive. He asked me, where you work? I said, Southern Pacific. He said, you Southern Pacific. You know Manuel Santos Fernandez? I said, do I? He's my helper. See, some of the locomotives still had acetylene gas lights. And his job was to put in the acetylene and then light the lights at 6 o'clock at night. Only the passenger engines had electric headlights. So when I said that, he told the bartender, this man don't pay. Give him all he wants to drink. Because they were both from Cape Verde Islands. And he'd say, you know my cousin, Louis Gomez? I said, sure, he run the All Nations Saloon. You see, I had that route. Between the Italian newspaper routes, that brought me all over town.
That's right.
Today, the boys have 3 blocks from home. That's all they go. I start in the marina down Montgomery Street, the Montgomery block, and lawyers. I'd have to climb stairs. There were no elevators, you see. Climb the stairs. Then I'd wind up at the foot of Mission Bay. The scavengers, see, they subscribed. There was 2 Italian papers. Now there's none.
No.
L'Italia and La Voce del Popolo means the voice of the people, yeah. Well, the French, I think the French have a newspaper.
I'm surprised. I hope it was still a...
Well, that brought me all around town. Then the railroad worked the same way. Well, the long hours, during World War I, I'd go and eat up at 20th and 3rd. And then I'd get acquainted with people. And it was full of hotels.
Third Street.
There's a couple left, New Potrero Hotel and further down. So I'd get around anyway. Then my mother'd take me to see Italians. They had vegetable gardens. Well, Bayview District was all vegetable gardens. Hunters Point had a brewery. There's a spring in the hills there. Somebody made a nice stone brewery out of the stone from the Hunters Point. It's still there, but not the brewery. Some artist brought it. During the Depression, you could have bought property for almost a song. At the foot of the hill there, there was two shipyards for wooden ships. Brower and Seamer, and Anderson and Cristofani. The bay was full of scows. Before 1900, they sailed up the Sacramento River and come down with wheat and bricks, gravel, hay. The hay was piled up so high they had to extend the steering wheel so he could look over the top of the hay. There's where Jack London come in.
I was going to ask you about Jack London.
The whole family would be asleep and they'd sail alongside and grab so 4 or 5 sacks of wheat, you know. Raid the oyster beds.
Now, this is what I remember hearing about him.
Well, this don't concern Potrero Hill.
No, but it does concern.
But you want to shut this off?
No, I think this is very fascinating.
Yeah, well.
Now, you told me the other day that you had,
they belong to the party, yeah.
And you both belong to the
Socialist Party.
Socialist Party.
Yeah. There was no IWW, there was no...
This predates.
Yeah. There was Comrade Costley. Open-air speaking was permitted on Grand Avenue and Market. Saturday night, there was pitchmen selling all kind of nostrums, you know. There was another man sold books on from the colony in Estero, Florida. The book says the Earth is hollow. When you go up to around the North Pole, you can sail inside the Earth.
Oh.
Incidentally, that colony dissolved about a few years ago, and they sold the real estate, and they made a lot of money. It was survivors.
Hmm.
And Ford and Firestone and Edison used to go down there in winter. And there's a place around Punta Gorda, they call 10,000 Islands. I had a sweetheart in the 20s. She was from Florida. And she told me she used to row to one island to a school, another one to the grocery store. And she wound up, married a banker's son in Richmond, and she made him buy a boat on the bay, something like Jack London. To sail around and then come down with cargoes of wheat and corn and stuff like that.
What were you? Where were you working when you were in the Socialist Party?
Well, I was working for the Western Electric.
Oh yeah, because you were an electrician.
Yeah, no, I wasn't I was a telephone electrician.
Oh, I see.
We were building all the switchboards. They burned up, and on top of it. At the same time, the American Bell decided to junk all the manual-operated switchboards. That is, you had to turn a crank, the operator had a crank there, and instead of electric lights, when a subscriber wanted to call up, a little shutter fell down. They still have them in the motherlode country, you see them, and you had to flick that shutter up again. And they said, junk all them, and the common battery system. You had to have 2 dry cells in each house. You see, now you don't have any dry cells. It's a common battery system. There's 1 battery in the central office that supplies electricity at 48 volts. Before that, you had to have turn the crank to ring up, you know. So they junked all that, and besides, well, we had orders from Vancouver, Washington, all the way down to San Diego. So I was working day and night. Oh, they'd ask you, 24 hours, nothing had worked. Sometimes 38 hours. Stay there till you finish. We built 80-line switchboards. I could only fit inside of one, you know, alone. I'd have to wire all these jacks. They call them jacks. And before that, I worked for the Eveready Battery Company. And I didn't like it. We made them by hand, these little flashlight batteries.
Yes.
The man says, there's a great future because you can speak Italian and Spanish. And I just laughed at him. Today, Eveready has been absorbed by the National Carbon, and the National Carbon was absorbed by the Union Carbide. So one day when I was working in the roundhouse, a man come down with some brushes for these generators. And I said, I used to work for that company. I said, where's Oakes? Oh, he's retired. He's a rich man. And where's Kaplan, the foreman? Oh, he's another rich man. See, they were tipped off to buy the stock. Mm-hmm. Buy the National Carbon, and then, you know what oxyacetylene cutting can do, you know. Today, they make oxygen so cheap and cut holes in steel that thick, with that flame. Mm-hmm. Well, in World War I, they didn't have that oxyacetylene. Everything had to be, you made a plate with a lot of holes that was punched, in, and it didn't fit exactly right. Then it was put alongside the ship, and if they didn't match, you had to ream it out. And then you had to heat a big rivet and throw it up there, and two men would hammer away at it. Today it's welding. There's no more riveting. There's a little riveting here, but the sides of the ship are smooth. Mm-hmm. See, that's why there was 18,000 men all night long, bang, 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 bang. And the railroads there was no other transportation, you know. No planes.
No.
No freight, anyway. No buses. You went to San Mateo and it was dusty. Roots in the dust. When you try to ride a bicycle, we rode down there and broke my forks. I hit a root in a tree. It was covered by dust, you know. Mm. And broke the forks and went spinning up in the air. So the railroad was the main method of transporting, and it reached its heyday about 1916.
And you went to work for the Southern Pacific.
Yeah, 1911.
And then that's when you worked in the roundhouse.
Yeah.
Right. When did you come to Potrero?
Well, I 1936, I decided to move down here from Twin Peaks.
Oh, I didn't know you lived in Twin Peaks. Yeah.
Because they started to put in traffic signals, and it was stop and start. I said, I'm going to move near where I work. You can get up and in 5 minutes I was home, and they had no time cards in them days or no. And I was the only electrician on the job. That was something new on a railroad, to have an electrician. Before that, the power was supplied by a steam engine. Then they started to put in electric motors, and they had electric headlights. The Pullman cars had a generator underneath that run by a belt. Well, I'll tell you how. In 1915, we had an exposition, one of the grandest expositions in the country's ever seen. The Bankers Convention had 36 special trains. We borrowed engines from even Mexico.
Hmm.
There was conventions every day. So the Mexican locomotives, instead of numbers, they had names, you know, General Velasco or General Delivery. They don't number their locomotives. I don't. Incidentally, the Southern Pacific used to run to Guaymas.
Oh, my.
Yeah, they was extended down to Guaymas, and the Mexican government bought them out.
Let's see. I think we'll continue on the other side of this.
Mm-hmm. Ask me questions, and I'll answer them.
And I was interested in hearing what else you had to say about the Panama Exposition. What else can you tell us?
It was built in Cow Hollow. There was just sand dunes and lagoons where the Chinese raised vegetables for Chinatown. Then when the Panama Exposition was projected, they started building it in 1913 or 12. Why, it encompassed all the marina from Fort Mason west to the Presidio. Every inch was taken up. They had, we had the Southern Pacific, Union Pacific, and I think the Great Northern had big locomotives there. And they were fired up at night, and the safety valve would pop off and a searchlight would shine on that. The Tower of Jewels was made of thousands of jewels, and later, when it was torn down, they sold for $1.50 a piece. They were made in Austria. Oh, it was a beautiful exposition. And that gave the public their first acquaintance with the Hawaiians. Before that, they were known as the Sandwich Islands. They had a vague Sandwich Islands and Kanakas that encompass all the islands, see.
Just as amazing.
So it was an education. Then the marimba band came up from Guatemala. They turned out beautiful music on them marimbas. Oh, and the Hawaiian building was full of tropical fish and plants. And the world got acquainted with the ukulele.
Mm.
But I liked the marimba band the most. Oh, that was beautiful music.
A few minutes ago, when the machine was off, you told me that you hated those trains.
Oh, Christmas, 8 or 9 extra trains for Los Angeles. That meant work for me because they'd bring these locomotives from Oakland or somewhere else, and the electrical equipment wasn't... I don't know. Boys didn't like to study then. They just gave me a bad time. Well, you got this off the air?
No, we're on.
Huh?
We're on.
Oh, I don't want to... People knew very little about electricity. I happened to go to Polytechnic High School, and I had a smattering of it. And it enabled me to carry on because with different kind of work, I had to climb poles and at night in the rain. They didn't have incandescent lamps. They had arc lights. You know what an arc light is? Two carbons, and they automatically go apart, and there's a big flame-like. And I had to climb the poles. They'd call me up. The ferry is in the dark down here, the car ferry. They ferry all these freight cars over from Oakland instead of going around the bay. Now they got the Dumbarton Bridge. They come over the Dumbarton Bridge. So I'd have to put a pair of climbers and climb up in the rain and change the carbon. But I knew I'll go in a roundhouse and get on the belly of one of them big locomotives and you would dry in 5 minutes. They were like a lot of horses. In fact, they put them in stall number 6. Put this one in stall number 7. The man that brings it in, they call him a hostler. See, a carryover from the stagecoach days. And they're just like a human being. When they come in, their air supply is exhausted. And they shut off the pump, but they generally don't shut it off tight enough. And all night long it's going, just like a tired man, you know. And I'd lay over them big boilers and I'd dry out in a minute. My work was on top. They had a turbine generator. And then the United States government made the most foolish move. Right in the middle of World War I, they issued an order, all locomotives have to have electric lights. So this poor little company that made these generators said we couldn't start to supply. So the government says put batteries on them, top of the locomotive. Big, heavy battery. I'd have to hoist it up and put it on top and take the old one off and charge it up. Besides doing all the other work. Go down here, go down there. From 6 at night to 6 in the morning. So whenever I had time, well, I'd go up Tennessee Street. And I got acquainted with the neighbors and the group.
It seems to me that one day you told me that Tennessee Street used to be one of the main thoroughfares.
It was.
It
was isolated. You couldn't get across unless you went road across Mission Bay. So they stayed there. They had their own opera house. Minstrel shows would come there, traveling shows, you know.
Mm-hmm.
They'd go way up the country, you know, like Cloverdale and Hopland. In fact, you know, I was up in Hopland in 1906 picking hops. And downtown, there was a traveling show. I can remember that song, "I'll Be Waiting for You, Honey Boy." You know, generally the opera house was over a livery stable.
Mm-hmm.
Martinez had them traveling shows. If it wasn't a traveling show, it was a traveling medicine man with a Negro and a banjo. The first time I heard She's the Yellow Rose of Texas, I heard it in 1894. There was an Italian medicine man. He had a Negro banjo player, and he sang it for me.
Hmm.
Well, he'd get a can of... he'd send us boys down to the bootblack stand and buy all the empty bootblack cans. Polished cans. He'd dip them in lye and take all the paint off. Then he'd put it with Vaseline. Well, a petroleum jelly. See, Vaseline is a trade name. The real name is petroleum jelly. And he put a little eucalyptus oil in, and he got $1 a can for it.
Oh.
Well, you see, you could hang out a sign, professor. You couldn't say doc, but the law permitted professor, see, so people got a hold of these. The induction coil come in that raised the voltage, and there was a lot of quacks put up a sign, electric treatments. In fact, up to 1930, they made a big belt, a loop, and you put it around your body, and I think they charged you $25 for it, or you could go into parlors. They had parlors all over town where you slipped this over your body, and they charged you 50 cents for a half an hour's use.
Was it supposed to charge you up?
Yeah, they had you. They were quacks, you know. You've got a book in the library about them. So one day, I think it was 1952, I see one in the street. And I ripped it open, and I give the wire to another electrician. He was going to use it for winding armatures.
Hmm.
Oh, that turn after turn of wire, about $5 worth of wire in it. Well, this professor, he came up from Los Angeles. He rented a front room in my house. I lived on Powell and Pacific. And he says, there's no future in Los Angeles.
Oh.
Well, it wasn't until they discovered oil around there. So Union Oil was established in 1890. And then the Standard Oil. Union Oil property, they sold a piece of land for $15 million that they bought just to drill and didn't find any oil on it. And then they tried raising avocados for a while.
Hmm.
They loaded with land, all their real estate, service stations all over California. If you ever liquidate, you'll surely make money on it. But, William, that's anybody's guess. Well, I don't know what this is going to hear. The Southern Pacific had one of the biggest deposits of oil in California. The land grant, every other section of land,
mm-hmm.
every 640 acres went to the state. The next 640 acres went to the railroad.
Mm-hmm.
Is that shut up?
Oh, yeah, don't blame you.
But them old-time engineers, they were a colorful bunch. They were from all over the world on account of the big railroad strike in 1896. The locomotive engineers went out on a strike, and so they hired engineers from Germany, from England, from France. Some had beards, you know. One man was an astronomer, out of work. And they were an intelligent bunch. Today, all that interest in how much he made more money than I did. He made more overtime. Every move they make is extra pay.
Well, changing times, I guess.
You know the squabble about the fireman? You see, a freight train has an engineer and the head brakeman. Today, there's no more steam locomotives. All the brakeman, all the engineer does is like running a big motor truck. And the head brakeman is sitting there to get down and open the key. The lock on a siding, to go on a siding, see. So they want another fireman in there. Well, they'd have no use for them. There'd be three men in a cab. And the railroads are almost bankrupt. The only good one is the Southern Pacific and the Union Pacific, because the land grants. The Union Pacific has the biggest deposit of coal west of the Mississippi River. Oil lands, uranium lands, they can carry on. Those eastern roads, especially around the New Haven, New Hartford, they have to carry the commuters, and there's no money in that. One wreck in the damage suits will wipe out any profits, see?
Yeah.
I want to ask you, bringing you back to a couple of things. You mentioned Tennessee Street.
At three churches.
Yeah, this was the main...
Main Street, police station, emergency hospital.
Police station is still near there.
Still there, yeah.
A hospital?
Yeah.
What was the hospital?
Oh, emergency hospital.
Oh, yeah, uh-huh. And the theater?
Yeah.
And...
Later on, when movies came in, they had a movie house around 20th and 3rd.
Now, that area has changed.
Oh, it's gone. They moved the church. The Catholic Church moved from 19 up to here in 1926. Oh, I remember this Portuguese helper of mine. He said to me one day, he told me all his troubles. He was a big, lanky. He came to the United States on a whaling ship. Nobody wanted them jobs, smelly jobs. So they stopped at Cape Verde Islands. And they'd say, yeah, you want to work on a whaling ship? When we get to New Bedford, you could hop ashore and lose yourself. Anyway, he said, Marzola, last night, devil come sit on my chest. I can't breathe. I said, you sure, devil? Oh, yeah. So the church was right around the corner, see. I said, Manuel, I noticed you passed the church. You didn't take off your hat. By golly, you right. I don't take off the hat. So the next day I watched him take off. You see, the mind over matter, you say, devil no sit on my chest anymore.
Oh my.
He was a character. He was the only man could splice rope in a roundhouse. He learned it on a whaling ship.
Imagine.
You see. You know, incidentally, San Francisco was whaling at headquarters from 1895 to 1905. You know why? All the whales, they migrate to Baja California, and they mate in the Gulf of California. Then they come up again. So they were harpooning them, and they land them at the foot of Folsom Street. I remember the William Bayless, the narwhal, and the bear. The big, big barrels of blubber and oil and water smell.
I imagine.
And they dried the whale bone. You know, they use it in women's corsets. You know, it was a strip of bone, and it was flexible. You could bend over and it'd spring back. And besides, they had steel in them, too, you know. So it was quite an industry. Oh, Saturdays and Sundays, we'd patrol the waterfront. We'd start in and wind up way down here. And as I said, the wharves were open. You could go on the end of any wharf. I don't blame the kids today for being delinquent. There's nothing to occupy them. We could go swimming. You know what Ghirardelli Square is?
Oh, yes.
Well, they had hot water from the Ghirardelli Chocolate Works running in the bay. And it kept the temperature of the bay a little bit warmer than the surroundings. So we'd go swimming whenever we got a chance, afternoon after school. And Clay Street Hill was clay. In summertime, we'd bring, each boy brought a can of water up there and poured it down the side of the hill. Then we had a sled. Instead of snow, we'd slide down a slippery clay.
Oh, my goodness.
So getting around to them Big Four's children, this wagon I made to carry the bread and flour at night, Saturdays we'd go up to Knob Hill because the streets were paved with asphalt. All the rest of San Francisco was cobblestones. So we'd come down the hill and then make a turn, you know, and these boys would be playing around at these. Give me a ride, and I'd watch the governors, you know. I'd give them a ride, and she'd come down and give me the devil. Afraid they'd get hurt, you know.
Well, when was this?
Knob Hill.
No, when?
Oh, around 1901, too.
Now, I remember you're telling me something, too, about the earthquake. Where were you?
Powell and Pacific.
You were living over there then? At Powell and Pacific, when the earthquake... Yeah,
right across the street from the... You see, the Southerners, when they came to California to get into the Gold Act, they brought their servants with them.
Uh-huh.
And they were a very proud bunch. In fact, across the street from where I lived, there was the African Methodist Episcopal Church. They were all retainers of these rich people. And you know, the only thing that saved the North was the efforts. The first thing that saved the North was the $1 billion worth of silver and gold that come out of Virginia City. You see, the Southerners, there was a lot of Virginians who were very proud. They wanted us to secede from the North. They wanted California.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. The free state.
And England was on the southern side. They wanted that cotton, and they loaned money to the planters. They're afraid that if the North would probably tie up the cotton production. And what little navy we had dissipated. We had the Monitor, little cheese box affair. In fact, one of the pipe fitters he was descended from, his name was Erickson. He said, my grandfather built the Monitor. The Merrimack was a Confederate boat with steel rails for armor. The Merrimack had a revolving turret, you see. Well, anyway, we were almost bankrupt till they discovered gold up and silver. And then Mr. Sutro made a 10-mile tunnel onto the mountain so to drain the mines. The water got in there, hot water, you know. They went down so far and they couldn't breathe anymore and they couldn't work. So he says, I'll build a tunnel. And then he made a fortune selling stock. I see it revived, the Sutro Mining Company now. This fellow Howard Hughes is buying all them abandoned mines up there. They went from $1,000 down to 1 cent a share. Around 1902, the mining exchange was down in Montgomery in California, and I see them widows that go down and look at the quotation board. They shawls. They wore shawls in them. They shawls were so old, they were green, turning green. And they'd look up there in hopes that they'd have a comeback. They had Hale and Norcross, the Virginia Consolidated, the Ophir mine, they had dozens of them. And every afternoon paper had the mining quotation, you know. In the morning, these old widows would come down and living in hopes. Well, it's Howard Hughes. Silver's coming back. You know who's the greatest user of silver? You couldn't guess. Eastman Kodak Company.
Really?
Oh! Everybody, kids have got cameras. You go down in the fishing room, snap, snap, Chinatown, snap, snap. These movie films are stored, and then when they obsolete, they send them to a chemical company, they take the silver out. Silver nitrate. They're the greatest consumers. Then, with the advent of machinery, every starter now has got silver buttons on the contacts. See, copper gets oxidized by the oxygen in the air, and once it's oxidized, it's a non-conductor. Silver does, it gets burnt, it oxidized, you know, but it's still a conductor of electricity, so there's a big demand for silver. So these gamblers, they call it the futures. You can make a deal with, you go down any stockbroker, says, I'm willing to deliver silver in 1971 for $1.80 an ounce. He'd take you on. I'll go broke maybe. It'll be $2 an ounce. I'll have to buy it in the open market. Everything is bought for the future. There's ways of protecting yourself, see? And I'm sorry for the poor buyer that don't protect his company. They protect it by buying a year from now, see? Pork bellies, that means the size of the hog used for making bacon. Big speculation in that every day. The wheat, cotton, silver. What's the latest commodity they're gambling in? Wait a minute. They're buying futures in everything. Oh, orange juice. They're speculating in orange juice.
Orange?
Sure. Now you see what happened in the Middle West? They found out the corn has got a blight. There's a fungus in the corn. If the corn crops falls off 25%, you won't see prosperity in the United States. Bacon will go up, ham will go up. They lay off these packing houses lay off because the corn isn't available. And we're the greatest corn-growing country in the world. So, you see, they're speculating, these fellows. Some of them men have 12 telephones from all over the world. They're listening here. How's the crops in Argentina? How's the crops in Sweden? You see? And they make the, well, it's like betting that the price is going to go up, and the other fellow says the price is going down. Great speculation.
Going back to 1906.
Yeah.
Did you have any particular experience in the earthquake? Can you remember it?
Well, the second day of the fire, I decided to go sightseeing. So I landed up at Portsmouth Square. National Guard said, come here, young man. He gave me a big pan. He says, go in them ruins and pick all the decayed meat of human beings, whatever you have. And I had a big hole dug in Portsmouth Square. We dumped all them bodies down the hole. And I was in April, and it was raining, and I washed my hands a dozen times.
Oh.
He said, you can go home now, but keep out of here. And then the next day, I run into a man with a camera. And it was a big, bulky affair, and he had a lot of plates. He says, you carry this, and I'll give you a couple of dollars. So we went around the ruins up Knob Hill, and he'd take the picture of the ruins, and he says, get in the picture. So I did. And one day I was going out Market Street. Oh, this was about 1917 or 18. In an old bookstore, I found a book with my picture in every page, you know. The camera company was name is Hodkins. I should have saved it, but you know, I moved around. I lost this and I lost that.
That would be nice for you to have.
Hmm?
That would be something that would be nice for you to.
Well, someday I'll locate one somewhere.
And you mentioned, too, the other day about bubonic plague.
Oh, yeah, 1901. Some rats got off of some ship that came from China, and they infected a lot of Skid Row characters.
Mm-hmm.
Skid Row used to be on Clay Street.
I was going
to
say, was it always on Third? It wasn't.
No, Clay Street. In fact, the Salvation Army had a restaurant, 1 cent a dish. Soup, 1 cent. Beef stew, 1 cent. Beans, 1 cent. And they'd be down the Barbary Coast at night, you know, with the drum laying on the street, you know, and they'd sing, where's my wandering boy tonight? And these drunks would start to cry and throw a half a dollar on a drum. Even the girls would go in a house of prostitution with the tambourine, you know. They weren't bashful. They were, and they, that restaurant was on Clay Street, 1 cent a dish.
Mm. Now, when did the bubonic plague?
Oh, 1901. Anyway, you know, they had an unwritten law. You've heard of them Kearney riots, where the Irishmen, even Jack London used to rave, kick the Asiatics out of California. Well, anyway, there's an unwritten law by the Tongs. No Chinese shall ever harm a white man. So the federal medical Dr. Blue, that was his name, I remembered. They went in all the buildings and carried the furniture and possessions out in the street. They were going to burn them up. And they were disinfect all these houses with chloride of lime, like a whitewash. He sprayed it all around. And then they hired Pinkerton patrolmen to watch nobody come in or out. They had a rope all around Chinatown, big rope. So my mother had a habit of getting up early, and we only lived a block away. She says, hey, boys, I had three brothers, you know. There's beautiful silk gowns. You know, the men wore gowns and the women wore pants, the mandarins, you know. And they have beautiful vases. They're going to be destroyed. It's a shame. So he says, we'll go down and get them. We looked around, and Pinkerton and the men were all asleep. 5 a.m, you know. So we carried them home. We had them on the back porch. We had beautiful cloisonné vases full of dirt. And when the earthquake came, I laid in bed. I didn't get up. The ceiling, I was watching. Pretty soon I hear plop, plop, plop. We lived on the top floor, you know. And they would shake, I'd hear them drop down. And the next day, the army came and give us 30 minutes. Get out of here. We're blowing up the whole block. Mm. You see, they wanted, the order was get rid of Chinatown. Blow up the buildings. Let them burn. The fire department made no effort. There was a little water available. From my back porch, I could see a windmill in Chinatown. And they must have had a tank, but the order was get rid of it. See, them houses were built in the gold rush days by rich people. They were nicely built, but they were full of fleas. They put 30, 40 Chinamen in one room, even in basements. Well, anyway, I grabbed a blanket, and my mother grabbed a blanket, and the boys each got a frying pan and a coffee pot. And off we went to the marina. It was all sand dunes. And pretty soon the Army gave us a tent, supply of corned beef and hardtack. About 3 days later, these trains arrived from all over the California, and then later from back east, even Vichy water. They sent a carload of Vichy water, canned fruit. Well, the cannery, there was piles of cans. The cannery burned down, but inside the pile, the labels were scorched, but they were edible. Oh, we had canned peaches. Right where Gas House Cove is over there. Well, you know where that Safeway store is?
Yes.
Right across in the, right there we camped. And then we moved up to Twin Peaks and we lived in a tent. And then my mother says, well, land was cheap. We paid $500 and there was water up there. There's still a spring up there. And there was a German, he was a civil engineer, and he built the first electric line that ran up to the, from 18th and, it run over to the switchback and then over to the park. His name was Juiced.
Oh, it was street.
Huh?
We have a street, Juiced.
Yeah, and he had three big wooden water tanks full of water. And he charged us $1 a month for all the water we could use. And there was the springs on here, on the hill here. One at Hunter's Point where they still bottle water. They call it Mountain Springs.
Do we still have one here?
Hmm?
Do we still have one
here? Oh, no, there's a house across the street from me. The backyard is always full of water.
Is that from the spring?
Yeah, there's a spring. Oh, you know, the rainfall. At Alamany Boulevard, they confined at Isla's Creek in a 10-foot tunnel, I mean sewer. First they filled it with gravestones. The graveyards all started at Divisadero Street, west. So when they demolished that graveyard, all the stones were thrown in. I picked up two or three of them and gave them to Mr. LaGrille. I don't know if you know him.
Name is it?
Well, he teaches art in San Francisco State. His wife, professor of English, San Francisco State. They live about 283 Texas. And he's got 2 or 3 degrees in art. He used to be a great friend of Benny Bufano.
Oh, yeah.
And I used to bring him these stones. I'd find them over Isla's Creek before they... Now it's Alamany Boulevard. It was a big ravine. And as I said, the garbage service didn't start till 1896. Before that, you dumped. Everybody was glad for you to dump garbage. If they had a hollow place, fill it up. You see.
Well, now, you mentioned coming to the Hill as a resident around 1936.
Yeah.
You must have seen many, many changes here. Can you talk about some of them?
They had row after row of identically built houses on Minnesota Street.
Are these row houses?
Yeah, they were little cottages.
Uh-huh.
And, of course, none of them had garages. And Tennessee Street, when I started to work, was full of houses. And little by little, they disappeared. Then the church moved up in 1926. Oh, there was a lot of places. In 1936, I was looking for a place to buy. And one around the corner here, I had my eye on that, but Then I decided to live closer to the roundhouse. Uh-huh. Oh, I seen a lot of changes. The soap works used to be down where the Jackson Park is.
The soap works?
Yeah.
Yes. What happened to them?
Well, they moved up
over,
here.
Over toward the...
They're on DeHarrow.
DeHarrow. Now, that's in the general vicinity of where the new junior high is going to be. Isn't that
and then they had an incinerator where they burned all the city's garbage. It had a big chimney, went way up in the air, and the sky was glare, you know, and the smell. And then they tore that down, and then the SP hauled all the garbage to Bay Shore, and it filled in around Brisbane. And this Mission Bay, while it was filled in, the water had come up, and the weeds had grown, that wild dill, it goes 8-9 feet high, and that was a hobo jungle, and they'd pour through this garbage.
Now, where was this?
Right at the 16th and 3rd Street.
Oh, yeah. A hobo jungle.
Hobo jungle.
Hmm.
And they were importing a lot of tequila or misbranded liquor. The federal agents, you see the viaduct, the old viaduct over the railroad tracks, they drive up there and then they dump it right down in the gondola cars. They had a hammer, they break each bottle, and it filtered all through all that garbage, and the hobos are underneath with 5-gallon cans. Why, they'd drink embalming fluid if they could get a hold of it. And then they'd pour through the garbage, they'd find silver spoons and knives and dishes that was accidentally discarded, you know. And mm-hmm. You went down, and they had campfires at night, and the SP was easy on them because if you irritate them, they would steal the waste out of these axles under the freight cars. There's a mass of waste saturated with oil, and it presses up against the journals, see. Well, if you take that out on the road, they get a hot box, and sometimes it breaks off and derails. So the order went on, especially during the Depression. Yeah. I've seen families even move a stove into a boxcar, and the brakeman says, where are you going? Well, I'll put you off at that town, see. They didn't charge any fare on a freight train.
Right.
They put a mattress on. So the order went, go easy on them. In fact, I remember my form. You know, they paid once a month. It was gold money, gold and silver. They don't have any paper money out here. The foreman can have Mark, go down to the tunnel, see if you get some hobos to go to work. So I'd go down there and say, hey, come on, you want a job? One fellow said, oh, yeah, I like a job, but I got no money to live on. I said, you don't need no money. You just sign a payroll deduction voucher, and I'll take them to Panama Hotel, 6th and Brannan, $13 a month, room and board, and a bottle of wine with each meal. Mm. $13. That was 13, 14, mm-hmm. 15.
Mm-hmm.
So I'd round up these hobos. Because you see the trouble with unions today, you're a prisoner. Your own union card won't let you work in Oakland. To go to work over Oakland, only in a boom over there, you got to pay a working permit. You see, so he's a prisoner. He's got a Social Security number now. Before they were boomers. Oh, I'm going to Florida. How can I go on to Florida, the East Coast? They're moving oranges now. There's a lot of work. And I'm going to New Orleans. They quit every payday. You see, they call them boomers, barbers and machinists. They couldn't stay put. They were restless.
Mm-hmm.
Then we had a breed of men. After every war, there was a breed of men that were, they call them strike breakers or filibusters.
Yeah.
When we tried to get the Panama Canal, see, the French started to build it and they gave up. And Colombia wouldn't give us the right-of-way because England opposed it in Germany. So we sent a gang of these ex-soldiers down there, and they started a revolution and took over.
Oh
so the government of Colombia, it belonged to government of Colombia, but then with these revolutionists hoisted up the Republic of Panama. And we gave them $15 million. I think in 1936, we gave them $25 million more in $10 million installments. You see, they were mad that we took over. I was down there in 1897. I could see all that old machinery rusting away that the French... They had to conquer the yellow fever first, you know. And we learned that from the Spanish-American War, you see. I don't think there was 300 men killed in the Spanish-American War. They died of ptomaine poisoning. The corned beef was hand-sorted cans, and they leaked. And yellow fever. See, so they finally, they put a soldier in bed with a yellow fever patient. They tried it 2 or 3, he never got yellow fever. So now some Spanish doctor says, I think it's a mosquito. So they put him in a room with a yellow fever, and then they introduced a lot of mosquitoes. And the mosquitoes bit the yellow fever patient, and they bit the soldier. One of them died, and two of them survived. So then they concluded it's a mosquito, you see. Oh, well, there are no toilets in the... In Panama City, the people that squat right on the ground do their... girls especially, one-piece dress. Squat down. The only... Huh?
Go ahead.
The Chinese had the only bath... The hotels didn't even have bathtubs. You went down to a Chinese bathhouse. Old cast-iron tubs, you know. They didn't learn how to enamel them yet. And you paid him the fee, and you'd take a bath. He gave you a bar of soap, a small bar of soap, and a towel. Oh, incidentally, James Lick, I mentioned he's an eccentric. He felt sorry for the poor workers of San Francisco. He built a free bathhouse at 10th and Howard. It's still there, but it's a Chinese laundry now. It's a brick front building. It burned down, but it rebuilt it. For free, you got a towel and a big bar of soap. And then they found out, oh, they had big tubs. They found out that the women stayed in there too long, so they peeked in and they found them washing their clothes in the tubs. They bring them in their bosom. So then they charged 5 cents. And the people said, oh, I told you there was a gimmick to it. Well, anyway, he built the James Lick Hotel. He made a fortune in real estate on Montgomery Street. And he lived in the basement room when he could have lived in the president's suite if he wanted. And he had his meals carried down to him. He never went in the dining room. So then when he got older, he left him some money for this industrial school. The Lick Observatory, southwest of San Jose, 25 miles southeast of San Jose. You ever been down there? Oh, it's a nice drive. And he's buried under the main telescope. And he left a Lick old lady's home. It's out here in the Portola district. Bacon and San Bruno Avenue.
Is it still the same name?
No, now they call it University Old Lady's Home.
Offhand, I'm not familiar.
Yeah.
Now, what?
I looked it up today in a phone book. It's still there.
What other changes have you seen on the hill? You mentioned to me one...
Well, that Irish hill is gone.
Yeah, that was leveled, apparently.
And all the vegetable gardens are gone. And the... you ever see that house at 18th and Tennessee, built in 1873?
18th and Tennessee... it's on a corner.
Yeah.
And it's
well,
got a lot of greenery. And
yeah, that's it, a lot of trees. On it. See, the bay used to come almost up to that house. See, here's Tennessee Street here.
On the map, yes.
Yeah, see, and you just happen, quarter of a block away with the water, see. So he was right here about, see. Then they made this bridge from 4th and Townsend. Then they threw dirt over as the years progressed, and it finally filled in.
And that was all filled in, right?
Yeah.
Was this Southern Pacific again?
Yeah, this is all the railroad yards down to here now. They left a little channel here. The ships could sail up to 8th and Brannan. There was a sugar refinery there. The ships come from the Sandwich Islands with the raw sugar. Oh, a lot of changes. They had Irish families up here. They had a cow, and one woman had two or three goats. And well, anyway, none of these cows, they were all tubercular, you know. Mm. I went to work for a... There was a man, my dairy man, said, you want to make 20 cents and a gallon of milk for 3 hours' work? He'd come by with a two-horse team, and he went somewhere, and I'd drive his team from 4 to 7, two-horse team, and the milk was carried in 10-gallon cans, and they were never sterilized.
Or covered.
The cows were tubercular. Mm. You left your pan out the front door, and... I got that gallon of milk. I proceeded to drink it every day, and I come down with tuberculosis of the stomach, of the ankle.
Oh, my.
Boy, I almost died.
Mm.
You see, I was drinking too much of that milk, and I couldn't cope with it.
I should think not.
And that's another story. I was given up to die. They operated on me, broke my jaw in Cole Cooper Medical College.
Where is that?
Sacramento and Webster.
And that's now something.
It's something else. Oh, the original building is still there. Anyway, they left a hole in my stomach. It wouldn't heal. Then that old pus had come out. So the doctor come to my house. He says, well, he'll be dead in 2 weeks. So when I heard that, there's a little alley off of Jackson and Powell. There was a family there that made lariats. They had a spinning wheel. And that was a rope alley where they, a rope walk. Mm-hmm. And the place was full of old discarded cow's tail.
And that's near the Pinyon.
Yeah, it's in a rather, where my cottage, where I lived, is Pinyin. Uh-huh. But the alley's still there. And the medical center, Chinese medical center, is right there. I often thought, well, them flies, I hate to kill a blowfly. They were lapping up that pus, and I'd watch them, you know. I was only 11 years old, 1900.
But that really worked for you?
Hmm?
That really worked for you, exposing your chest to the sun.
Sure. So that's before antibiotics were discovered. World War I, they actually put maggots in a soldier's arm. He cleaned out all the... They evidently have a disinfecting power.
Hmm.
You know what pigweed is?
No.
Well, it got another name, purslane. It grows in the backyard, and you put it on pork. And it. Well, in Peru, when my brother, you see, we were on, each boy had a horse. We're going over the mountains, and the lightning struck about a half a block ahead, bang, and a thunder, and the horse reared up, you know, and bolted away, and his foot was in a stirrup. And he repeatedly bounced around, and his scalp was completely off. So we got some cholos, and they went and got, it looked like pigweed. And they pounded up and made a big pile of it and mash, and they slapped it on his head. And they made a litter, and they carried him to Cerro de Pasco, which is the highest city in the world. It's the highest inhabited place in the world. That is for a city. Mm-hmm. Lhasa in Tibet is only 12,000 feet. And Cerro de Pasco's almost 15,000. And the Cerro de Pasco mine is 16,000 feet. So there's a lot of cure. Now, quinine came from Peru. Those Indians on the Amazon River in Peru, on the east side, it's raining all the time, the green hell. The vegetation is 10 times denser than in Africa. These hippies are going down there now and getting from the witch doctors, they're getting these yagi and different herbs that give you hallucinations. See, Leary went down to Mexico, and these Mexican witch doctors, they call them curanderas. They said, we got a mushroom for you, but for a price. The hallucinations. The potato came from Peru.
Yeah, I remember reading about that.
Way up, that's the only thing the cholos eat, way up high. They're little green potatoes, and they have guinea pigs running in and out the house. The beds are made of clay, adobe, and they're hollow. Mm-hmm. You sleep on top of the bed with llama blankets, mm-hmm. and these guinea pigs running in and out, and the chickens are roosting over your head. A thatch roof, and the llamas in the morning are trying to get it, eat the edge of the roof off. And if you open, and you open a door, and there's only a rug, they'll stick their head in. And you know, they're very friendly, the llamas. Mm-hmm. So, call it chupi. They'll kill a guinea pig, and they bring the onions up from the lower levels. Mm-hmm. You can look down a valley, you'll see vegetation. We're way up there on the altiplano. Nothing grows, only a grass like Negro's hair. And they, like turf, they cut it with a spade, let it dry, and they burn it. They get down and the stove is made of adobe clay. And the pots are made of clay. Mm-hmm. And they make that soup, you know, chupi, they call it. Mm-hmm. And that's their main staple is potatoes. Oh, but they like it. That is, they like to live up there. When you bring down the lowlands, they suffer. And you suffer if you go up there. You can't breathe.
No, this is what your system gets used to. I guess what your system gets used to.
Oh, yeah. Boy, you can get used to anything.
Now, back to San Francisco after Peru.
Yeah.
We're talking about changes on the hill. I've seen some.
People are not friendly anymore. You know, as I say, the boys, right here at 18th and Texas, mm-hmm. they had the Mayflower Club. The boys rented a building, and twice a week they gave dancing. You'd see, well, over the waves and the Japanese Sandman, and the girls would go down, and the union forbids that now. You can't play, and they don't want you to play and charge
admission,
see. And Potrero, down in Potrero, they had the Sea Wolves, the Primrose Club, very sociable. And the mothers would come down, and here's Mrs. Dunn and Mrs. Aya. Her name was Anastasia. Religious names, you know.
What about that theater on 18th, on Connecticut near 18th?
A Hindu run it. He was a graduate mechanical engineer from India. He run it and gave you pictures about 3 months old, and he only charged you 50 cents.
Was this a movie house?
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
His wife was alcoholic. She was a white woman. But the Negroes, the women come down, ho, 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 and they drink a bottle of gin and throw it down the aisle. And then the union, with the advent of television, the attendance dropped off. And he paid his operator $5 an hour. He paid him $25 for 3 hours work or 4 hours work. So he told a man one day, listen, I'm not making it. I don't take in $25. I'm going to run it myself, the machine, see. Mm-hmm. So they put 4 pickets out there and threatened everybody, you know, the union tactics. So I went and got an injunction from a judge. The judge says, well, he showed the judge his books. I'm not making $25. So the judge put a restraining order.
On the pickets?
Yeah. So they disappeared. He run till these Negroes come up here. Drunk, noisy, dirty. You couldn't hear what the picture was saying. It was ho-ho and loud talk and giggles. And so he folded up. He owned that Powell Street Theater. It's Powell right next to Moore's.
I know that, yeah.
Yeah, well, he used to own that, but I don't know what become of him. I asked the ticket seller down there what become of the. You know, he's a very nice man, well-educated.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Oh, my wife and I used to go up there twice a week. See. And then that dry goods store, that folded up.
Munter's very recently.
And, he got robbed so many times. That poor cleaning woman down there at Texas and 18th, she got robbed.
Well, the cleaners up here, too.
Yeah, well, they're primitive people. They gradually, these youngsters that grow up, they'll gradually evolve, you know. I notice there's not many boys come in and read books. I started in branch number 2 was on Powell and Vallejo. They had 2 old maids. They put in long hours.
Mm-hmm.
And when the earthquake come, there was all the libraries were destroyed downtown. There was only one at 18th and Pond Street. It was McCreary Library.
Yeah, and that was damaged in the
57 earthquake. Yeah. But that was a godsend. I'd hike down from the top of Twin Peak, no transportation. Mm-hmm. I'd walk down, and they had... there was a magazine called A Scrapbook. Mm-hmm. And a Literary Digest. Mm-hmm. And I'd read them and what they had. It was a godsend because all the theaters were burned up. They were all downtown. So there was a place out, 10th Avenue in Fulton. It was a shoot... was an amusement park, and they happened to have a big theater. And the Orpheum, which was a nationwide circuit of A number one vaudeville, see, the best acts from Europe and England, they moved out there, and I'd hike from Twin Peaks over there and come home late at night, no transportation. You had to walk through the park, never got held up or anything, see. People were different. It's the automobile consumes the people's earnings. And that's gone. That's capital gone, gone down the drain. We could build, the bartenders, they had all the empty beer glasses, there'd be an inch of beer that emptied, and they had a little drain and went in a big can. Pretty soon some wine bum would go, hey, you, yeah.
Get them from the drain glasses?
Yeah. Okay. Oh, say, incidentally, the order went around in 1939, the federal order went around, the drugstores couldn't sell paregoric anymore without a prescription, so they were stocked up and the labels were getting old. So it was hauled down to the dumps here, you know, and thrown in them garbage and all them bums in the jungle there. Yeah, paregoric is opium. And alcohol, pure alcohol. So they drank them bottles. They were unconscious for a week.
Isn't that supposed to put on baby's gums?
Yeah, for diarrhea and colic and everything else. So they had a grand old time. They had a woman hobo. She's still down there. I'll bring up a picture I cut out of the Chronicle.
Oh, I'd love to see it.
Huh?
I'd love to see it.
But she's a claustrophobia. She can't be confined in walls. When the roundhouse moved away, there was a nice garden left by the engineers. See, they only work an hour and a half in the morning, an hour and a half at night. Meanwhile, they idle. They go to picture shows. They're paid for a full day's work, you know. So they made a nice garden. When they moved out, I took a walk with my dog, and my dog was sniffing. There was a little ditch about that deep, you know. And there was a piece of cardboard over, and I see the cardboard moving, my dog. So I lifted it up, and she said, get out of here. Let me sleep. I said, who are you? Never mind, I want to sleep. So I went home and I threw some old blankets down there. And the next night I went down and I bought her some food. So she told me, my name is Alma. That was in 1960. She's still around. She scrounges around. People give her old lunches and she looks in every garbage can. So.
What I know of.
I asked her, did you ever work? Yes, I worked in laundries. Now, one day I met a man worked for the city hall, and he looked like he was alcoholic. Over in Golden Gate, you know where them apartments are on the waterfront? They have a private park. Yeah. So we got talking, and I said, you know, there's a hobo woman there, and she's from, he said, where's she from? I say, Fergus Falls, Minnesota. She's a... Norwegian descent. He's from Minnesota, so he says, Fergus Falls. You know what Fergus Falls is? That's a crazy house. So she must have been confined in a crazy house, and they taught her laundering. Mm. But she sleeps in the weeds. Mm. A spider as big as walnuts walk over, she don't bother. And you bring her a sandwich, she lays it down on the ground, pretty soon it's full of ants. She eats ants and all. I think she's a little bit alcoholic, too, because I see wine bottles around. And that creek, the channel, that used to be the greatest hay market. All these horses required hay, and every day these scows, they were sailing boats, flat bottom, so you could go way up to Sacramento River. They unloaded their hay there.
Is this the one that runs near Blanche's?
Yeah.
What's that called?
The channel.
That's the channel.
Yeah. And you can see by this picture, it extended up to 8th and Harrison. Well, this side, the north side of the channel, was all hay and grain. Mm-hmm. And there's still a man down there, his name is Deming. He sells hay and alfalfa. And believe it or not, the amount of women that buy pigeon feed.
Oh, really?
I didn't mention that the tidal on the hill here was very cloudy. Before the earthquake, even, there was 2 or 3 contestants. And when the earthquake came, the city hall burned down and all the records. So if you had a house, you had to hire an attorney to establish your claim to your own piece of land. They call it a McInerney title after the lawyer's name. See? Hmm. You posted a notice on your house. Any claimants appear to City Hall, such a date, the new City Hall, you know, and bring your witnesses. And if none did appear, the court would grant you a title. They call it a McInerney title.
Why was there a problem? Why was there a problem?
All the records were destroyed.
Oh, that's right, destroyed.
Marriage records, birth records, everything was destroyed. The old City Hall was built by politicians. Massive, big columns, they were hollow. They were filled with empty cement barrels, which incidentally, there was very little cement made in California. It all came from Europe as ballast. You see, they came here to Martinez to load wheat. The Southern Pacific had, the port cause had a mile-long dock loaded with wheat. And Glenn County produced more wheat than all the gold produced in California, Glenn County alone. You see, there was no market for the fruit until the Pacific Express was, you know, refrigeration. It's jointly owned by the Union Pacific and Southern Pacific. Then they pushed them cars over the back east with lemons and oranges and peaches and apples. And before that, wheat was a Contra Costa County. Incidentally, after the bubonic plague spread to the rats, them fleas spread it to the squirrels. There were squirrels all over Twin Peaks. And over in Oakland, Contra Costa County, they were a pest. Mm. So they got the bubonic plague. And then it spread down to the San Joaquin Valley. They call it tularemia. The same disease, when it goes from one animal to the other, the characteristics change. And then it spread to the Rocky Mountains. Today they call it Rocky Mountain fever. Yeah. The ticks. That was a result. Now they have to have a big disc on the ropes, you know, to prevent the rats from coming ashore.
Well, Mr. Marzola, I certainly appreciate all your time and all your information.
Oh, yeah, I heard you.